Just blurring out with Eric Blair's show at the 2020 NAMM, and I'm here with the drummer of Alice Cooper, Glenn Sobel. Glenn, how are you doing today?
I still got my voice.
Yeah, you look good.
Thanks. The NAMM hasn't gotten to me yet, and it's not going to get to me this year. I'm not getting sick.
Is that what happened?
Well, everyone gets the NAMM-thrax, they call it. You never heard that before?
No, I haven't.
Oh, well, now you have NAMM-thrax. It's the sickness you get because you're shaking hands and you're talking to people that are this close to your face and they're spitting on you and you can't sleep because your brain is going nuts from all the gear you check out all day and the people you meet, and you get sick.
Well, how did you get your gig with Alice Cooper?
Oh, man. Deep stuff. Basically, the short story is that I did a recording session for him in 2010 where we were remaking note for note some Alice classics, and he re-sang it. Why? Because when there's a movie, video game, TV show that wants schools out of one of those, there's a newly recorded master and the old record label gets cut out of the whole thing. It's like a loophole. I probably wasn't supposed to say that, but too late. So that's how that happened. And it led to the tour a year later. I was suggested for the tour. And I had not met Alice at the time. I recorded for him, but you often don't meet the artist that you record for. So somebody suggested my name. He had sang over my tracks and he needed to see me, so they pulled up some YouTube because his drummer couldn't be a guy boring and looking down at himself. He had to be someone that had a sense of showmanship. Based on that, Alice said, that's the guy.
Tell me about Alice's work ethic.
Oh, he's just always going. He's always got to be doing something. There's a record, there's a tour, there's an appearance, there's a guest appearance on somebody else's record. It just goes and goes, and we got to keep up with him. I'm not even kidding, man. He goes at it, and he likes to work a lot, which we're all really lucky for.
Why do you think Alice chose you for the position of drummer in his band?
Well, it was a combination of those things I mentioned. I had recorded for him, and he understood that I got the music, and he saw that I was a player that could utilize showmanship when it's needed, but also the people in the band, especially the one that recommended me, vouched for my character. Not crazy, not an alcoholic, not going to disappear. You'd be surprised how many people fall under those bad categories where they are just, doesn't matter how good they are, they're not going to get a gig because their reputation sucks because they blew it through just bad choices. I'll leave that at that, man. I mean, get me started.
And then what was it like working with Orianthe for the short period?
Oh, it was great. She did actually a couple years with Alice. And then since then, I've played on a lot of other shows and some recordings with her. And I played with her and Richie Sambora a little bit. And I just jammed with her and Robbie Krieger maybe a couple months ago in L.A. and did a recording with them. Sure. So she's obviously very talented, amazing. She's a good friend, and I hope her new record really does well. I haven't heard it yet.
Now, and also, you're a big fan of Brooklyn Allman.
Yeah.
So tell me about the connection there.
Well, I just met Brooklyn through Orianthe. That's one of her best friends, and they've collaborated a lot, and she's sang with Ori. She's joined us at our residency gig in Hollywood called Soundcheck Live, and she could belt it. She was in a band called Picture Me Broken, and they were out on the Alice Cooper Marilyn Manson tour as the opening act, and that's where we had all met. It's all connected.
How do you not succumb to sex, drugs, and rock and roll after all these years?
Well, 2 out of 3 ain't bad. I mean, come on. But no, look, being the drummer, you can't be that guy doing the partying, the drugs. You get older, you realize that more than ever that is the case. All right, there's a lot of stories about a lot of people that have done a lot of partying. Mostly they don't last. Being a hired guy, a drummer that does this for different artists, you got to be on top of your shit, man. You can't get into that world of partying. That's the reason a lot of people do it in the first place. The party is like the number one priority. It can't be like that. You got to love the music. And if you're going to try to hang out with everyone that wants to party and do drugs with you, that's the wrong path.
Nita Strauss, what kind of energy has she brought to the Alice Cooper band?
She's an acrobat. She's moving all over the place. She's been a very great addition to the band. I was just hanging with her earlier today. And she's just a go-getter. She likes doing guitar instruction and clinics like I love doing. And so when someone is into that teaching thing, that shows you that they're not just there to collect a paycheck and just to have a good time. We're really into paying it forward, and she does that all the time. She's great with the fans, and it's been, I think, 5 years for her now in the band. Flies by.
Glenn, what about recording with Alice? But I mean, recently, are you going to go in the studio and record any new music with Alice?
Well, the Hollywood Vampires record came out recently, the newest one, Rise, which I played on. And now the new thing he's doing, it's with a bunch of Detroit people. It's like a Detroit rock tribute project. But as far as I know, it's original songs. There was an EP that was some kind of little preview, and now there's a full record. A bunch of Detroit guys. That's Alice's original stomping ground. You know, at the MC5 and Iggy Pop, hanging with all them. So it's stuff that reflects back to that era. So he's got some guys from Detroit playing on there.
Now let's talk about the Hollywood Vampires. Tell me about touring with them. And I mean, what the personalities, Johnny Depp, all of these three legends. You're on stage with three legends, man. So what is that like? What are the personalities? How do they intertwine with each other?
Well, there's no complaints with that gig. I mean, it works when it can. We do have a lot of dates already scheduled for 2020, which is cool. I know that there's a lot of Europe that's been announced, and there's more to come. I can't say what yet because I don't know what's been confirmed. But in 2018, we did a couple months mostly in Europe, and that was killer. I mean, look, no complaints. Johnny loves to play music. He moved to LA in 83 from Florida with his original band to make it as a musician. Yeah. Kind of got sidetracked by the acting thing. Right, but he never lost his passion for making music and rocking out, and now he's able to do it at least part of the year, and he really got into this record. We all did, and there were some late night demo recording sessions at his house that would go till 6 in the morning because him and Joe Perry are literally vampires, you know. But yeah, Alice loves it. It's a different thing for him. It's looser. He talks to the crowd between songs. We do cool covers, and now we got the originals. And it's just a fun, cool gig. We get all these guests joining us on stage when we travel through Europe, and a lot of surreal moments, yeah.
These guys must be throwing history around while you're working with them.
A lot of stories, yeah. Being around Alice, just being around Alice and his management and producer Bob Ezrin, being around just them, there's stories for days. But yeah, you throw in Joe Perry in there and Johnny and everybody else that comes around. Yeah, there is so much just tidbits of great information you would never hear in a book, right? But yeah, it's very, very surreal hanging with these guys, and I love playing the shows. The energy is just super.
Do you recognize the music personalities of each person entering into the recordings while they're being done?
Oh yeah, Joe Perry picks up a guitar, you hear Aerosmith. Like if you listen to the Vampires record, when he plays a solo over a certain song, there it is. There's the sound of Aerosmith, and Alice obviously has his vocal stylings, but he's doing some things that I call more Alice's Jim Morrison type voice. He doesn't do that as much on the Alice solo stuff, but sometimes people don't recognize that that's his voice, so he's able to do something different from the solo recordings. You know, then Tommy Henriksen, he is really the brain behind this. Musical director, producer, was able to sort of corral all the ideas, get it all together, put riffs together, have it make sense. Johnny would write a ton of lyrics, and Tommy would write lyrics with him. And so a lot of those song titles come from the mind of Johnny. You know, Alice will tell you that.
That's crazy. So Johnny Depp is writing lyrics?
Well, yeah, he's providing a lot of the ideas, at least for a lot of the songs lyrically. Yeah, sure.
Why do you think the public has embraced...
He's a poet.
Yeah. Why do you think the public has embraced the Hollywood Vampires to a huge extent?
Something about these guys getting together, it created something that maybe they weren't aware of until we started jamming. In fact, it was NAMM 2014. The Vampires wasn't a thing yet, but we did what was called the Johnny Depp Band at this one nighttime party. And so as we were rehearsing in LA, Alice's manager was there and he was watching, and I think he was going, this could be something, you know. And then it did turn into the Vampires, and then Joe Perry got involved, and I think that's how it started. Don't quote me on that, but I think that was like the genesis of it.
Is the energy that you feel from an Alice Cooper audience different from the energy you feel from a Hollywood Vampires crowd?
There's a lot more screaming young girls at a vampire show. Yeah. But you know what? One feeds into the other. I know a lot of Vampires fans that had never been to an Alice Cooper show. When we came back through Europe with Alice, a lot of them came out because they became Alice fans. And then, of course, a lot of Alice and Aerosmith and Johnny fans come to the Vampire shows. They can be very different crowds, and the traveling can be very different. There's a lot of paparazzi and just fans waiting outside of hotels and airports. I don't know how they find out our flight schedules, but they always do. And it's different in that respect.
How do the guys treat the fans when they encounter them on the road?
Oh, they're amazing. Johnny will sit there, stand there, sign autographs, take pictures after the show for like a while at the rope line. Yeah, he is that cool.
What's next for you?
With Alice, I mean, I don't know when you'll air this, but with Alice, we're headed to Australia on February 3rd for a bunch of shows, including a benefit for all the fires going on down there, a benefit with Queen and a few other bands.
In light of the passing of Neil Peart, how did that affect you and your first Rush album that, like, changed your life?
Well, when I was 10, I got Exit Stage Left. That's where it all started, man, the live record. But yeah, that's caused quite a damper on this week, obviously. There have been some drum events earlier in the week where that's been a major focus, and there have been moments of silence in honor of Neil. I mean, he touched us in every way. For many people that aren't even Rush fans, he still affected what they did in one way or another. I mean, he brought drums to the forefront, big drum sets, melodic, constructive drum parts, the lyrics that he wrote. I mean, he was it. He sold a lot of drums. He created a lot of drummers, like myself. I didn't know I wanted to play drums until I heard that record. And then it was just game on.
The Blaring Out Show.